Hey, welcome everyone to this week's episode of the Amazon Files, brought to you by Mommy Income. I am your host, Kristin Ostrander, and I am so happy to share something with you, an interview that I was a part of with Dr. Amanda of NFA Money, and she talks all about money mindset and how to get us out of our own heads, money blocks and things like that that prevent us from reaching our highest potential. But first, before we get to Dr. Amanda, I really want to let you guys know that tomorrow is Amazon Prime Day for the next couple of days. And if you haven't listened to two episodes ago, go back and listen to the Prime Day episode because you want to be prepared for what is coming. It is like Black Friday in July, and there's still things that you can do to optimize your listings and get ready for Prime Day. So happy Prime Day tomorrow and the next with all of that. But also, there's something else special going on tomorrow. Something very special. July 12th, 2022. Live Wholesale for the Holidays class. Mommy Income Live class. Yes, I'm teaching wholesale for the holidays. And guess what? You're going to learn what you need to sell for the holidays, where to get it, how to get it in on time and in full so that you can maximize your profits for Q4 and the holiday season. Halloween, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and everything in between. There are more than just those things to prepare for. And if you're not ready or you don't know, if this is your first time around, I've got your back. But Wholesale for the Holidays, even if you're not into wholesale yet, it doesn't matter. You can get into wholesale. It's not too late for the holidays, but we got to do it soon. We got to prepare right now. So mommyincome.com/holidays. You want to register for the live class. Y'all, I don't teach live classes very often because I'm living life. I'm out there doing business and making money so that I can spend time with all the people I love doing all the things I love. That's why I do business. Not to just do business, although I love business. I love my family and my free time and my hobbies and everything more. So making more money to live life. So that's what I'm out doing. So I don't do a lot of live classes, but guess what? This is a special treat, live class. July 12th, mommyincome.com/holidays, wholesale for the holidays. This is coming. And guess what? I have a special, never released bonus that you might be able to have access to. It's very limited. And I don't do this often, but I really want to save you guys some time. We've had enough hardships, right? Can I get an amen? We've had a lot of hardships already this last couple of years. Wouldn't it be nice for something to be a little bit easier? I'm taking some stuff off your plate. I've done something and made something that is going to just save you so much time and energy, but you can only get it during the live class at Wholesale for the Holidays. But just remember, if you are a Hub member, you already have access to Wholesale for the Holidays live class. So come and register with your coupon code that you will get as a Hub member, if you're a Hub member. If you're not, I'd love to have you in the Hub. It is the Amazon Files Hub. It is open to wholesale bundle students only because we share proprietary information in there. You have to be a course member in order to join the Amazon Files Hub. But once you're in there, you get live coaching sessions every month and free training. For extra training, I do once a month training in the Hub. That's why you don't see it a lot outside the Hub, because it's in there. It's extra training for the people who want to be in there and advance their businesses faster and easier and get on with their real lives. That's what we do in the Hub. We get in, we learn, we ask questions, we take action, we move on, we build business so that we can live life. So if you want to be part of the Hub and you're a wholesale bundle student, mommyincome.com/hub. And if you are in the Hub, you get Wholesale for the Holidays for free. That's part of the Hub membership, is that you get perks for being a member. And when I do live classes like this or extra things, you either get discounts or you get free stuff. So you're welcome. I love your Hub members. You guys are awesome. And you get the class for free. So I hope you show up and ask questions and help the newbies as well. So we'd all love to have everyone in there. Wholesale for the Holidays, mommyincome.com/holidays. And I'm going to prepare you for that. Now, Dr. Amanda, I always mess up her last name. Barrientez, I think it is. Amanda Barrientez, founder of NFA Money, no effing around money is what her business is called. And she is not playing around. I'm not much of a big language person here, but you guys know that she is known as the money healer because she's an expert at teaching entrepreneurs, just like you, how to break through your unconscious money blocks and create money confidence that gives you ultimate freedom to design the life and business on your own terms. And we agree on those things. And Dr. Amanda is brilliant at helping pull out our money blocks so that we can get past them and just move on and really attract the clients and the customers that we really want to attract. And so she does really well at that. And I had the opportunity to be on her podcast as well. And this is the interview. So I hope you enjoy listening to it. Again, mommyincome.com/holidays. And I hope to see you in the live class tomorrow night. And same time, same place next week on the Amazon Files. And enjoy the interview with me and Dr. Amanda from NFA Money.
So psyched to have you here. So let's start with this. What would you say is your biggest current money fear? Something you're working through in the realm of breaking through a money block or a money fear that comes up for you in your business?
Great. And by the way, I love that you just start with the juicy questions. I mean, let's just get right to it, right? I mean, yes. Come out of the gate swinging. Okay. So one of my current struggles with money blocks right now is mo money, mo problems, right? You know, the more that you have, the more you're required to be responsible for. And I look at it as a resource and as a tool that I'm using, but am I using it the best way? And could I be investing it in the best possible ways? And where and how do I invest in the business to make it grow beyond where I've already grown? Because we're always, you know, sometimes we're growing and scaling and sometimes we're just maintaining. So I think part of the balance right now for my money block is really just like having a lot more of it and the resources that I need to do. What do I need to do to not only protect it, but also spend it in the best possible way?
God, these are big ones. I'm so curious for you, like, have you noticed that money block along the entire journey? Because I know that in different phases of businesses, we have different blocks come up. Would you say that's one that you've had that's been a pattern in your history of entrepreneurship?
No, not really. Most of the time I've been sitting around waiting for the money to come in so that I know exactly what to spend it on. I know exactly how to invest in order to grow my business and grow places. But at a point right now, I kind of feel like, what is not necessarily the next big thing, but what is the next thing that I really need to put my money towards to protect the empire that I'm building rather than continue building it, more of the protections around it so that it doesn't go backwards, so we don't lose it. I think that's part another money block that I tend to have. Yeah. Once I get it, don't want to lose it.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, it's an interesting one, right? Because it's like, of course, none of us want to lose our money. And do you, like, sometimes I notice sabotage patterns in some entrepreneurs where it's like they do get a certain amount and then they hit that money ceiling or their money set point and then they sabotage and bring it back down. Have you been able to, it sounds like you've grown to seven figures. So have you been pretty good about noticing these things as they come up in your business building journey?
Yes, I have indeed. You know, new levels, new devils, right? So when you're rising to a level, you really need to reevaluate where the money's coming in, reevaluate your budget, reevaluate your, and of course, that's why I love your mindset things, is because it's all about that mindset. Whether you have three zeros or three commas in your money bank or not, you still have, you know, different problems at different levels, and problems that I had before, I don't have those problems now. I just have new ones. So it's just no money, more problems, right? It's just different problems, not necessarily the same ones, but all within solutions. You just have to give yourself time to think about them and what you want to do with your money.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious, as you're playing with that money block, more money, more problems, are you noticing, like, who, and you said part of it is looking for the right strategist to help you know how to protect it. Mm-hmm. Where do you go to find that? What are you finding right now?
I look for people that have done it and been there and done it before. So mistakes that they've made that you can go to an expert and you can say, okay, now I'm at this particular level and I've got, you know, but as you're building your wealth and you're building different, your entrepreneurs, you want to protect your business, but you also want to be able to spend some of it too. I mean, let's be real. We make money so that we can enjoy it. And so I'm really looking towards the future. I've always wanted a beach house. And so I really have always wanted something that even if it's not necessarily owned or something I rent out, I'm looking for it as a possible investment to use it when I want and then rent it out there. So I'm looking at the possibilities of that and looking at people that have been there and done that to say, like, what do I avoid so that I don't waste a ton of money? Because actually what I hate more than wasting money is wasting time. So it's like one, they go hand in hand to me. Time is money. And so I'm always researching to try to find the best ways to do things so that I don't have waste.
Oh, I love this. Okay. Will you share some tips on time efficiency tools? Because I so agree, like, time is the most precious commodity we have. And if we're not aware and conscious of our time, we're wasting time and money, which, you know, isn't an effective business or high ROI business.
Well, and this is a hard one to talk about, of course, since we do talk about tough stuff here, right? All the juicy stuff. The hardest thing about the, what I consider like your time and your money and what's it worth is looking at your average dollar per hour. I mean, yeah, we don't want to break it down that way, but if I'm looking at my average dollar per hour, would you hire a surgeon to give you a booster shot? No, you wouldn't. You would not hire a surgeon at their cost and level to give you a booster shot. That can be someone else. And so every time I'm looking at a task, something that has to be done, something that needs to be done, my question is, do I absolutely have to do this task? And if I don't, who is the best person to do this task and at what level? Because let's be honest, sometimes we're CEO and janitor at the same time. And once we hire team members and have people surrounding us to support us, there's usually someone else that can and or should be doing that task. So the number one thing I do is I look at the task and be like, does this have to be me? If it does not have to be me, who is the best person on my team for this job? And when I say my team, I don't just mean the people that I employ and pay paychecks to. My team is also my husband, my children, my mother, friends, family, Uber, the babysitting service, the Instacart, you know, these are things that, like, if you don't have to grocery shop, unless you love it, then you can literally hire that task for really a lot less than what you're worth per hour. So if your rate is $300 per hour and you could pay somebody $20 to go grocery shopping for you, you just gave yourself $280.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to do that task for that hour and you paid someone $20 to do it. So you reduced your rate by $20 and you're still doing the high level stuff at while your other things are getting paid for. So that's kind of how I best use time as money when I,
That is awesome. Okay. I'm going to ask everyone who's watching, comment, leave a comment. What are you going to choose to delegate away ASAP, right? So leave a comment about what will you delegate? And because this is exactly what Kristin is talking about. And this is how powerful seven-figure, six-figure business owners think. They go, my time is valuable. My money matters. My hourly rate matters. So if I can pay somebody else a lot less than me to do that task for that hour, then why wouldn't I delegate it away? I think I'm going to type this. Okay. So leave a comment. What will you delegate away? Okay. It's hard to talk and type at the same time. Well, delegate away. Okay. And then will you talk about this a little bit? Like, will you share first tasks that you started to delegate away?
Absolutely.
When you were like your first delegation people.
My first delegation was a babysitter when I was really in the thick of, when I was building business number one, which is my Amazon store that I sell on my e-commerce site. My kids were younger and they went to school and I couldn't afford a babysitter, which I actually hate using those words. That's like something that I discontinued from my language is saying I can't afford.
The word babe. Oh, I can't afford. I thought you just say babysitter. Yes. I was like, oh, interesting.
No.
Okay. I can't afford. Good. Yeah. Drop that. Language.
I hate that. That was just something that was a blocker from when I was a kid. And I decided when I grew up, I was never going to be able to not afford. I was just going to change the language so that I can say, you know, that's not a priority for me right now. But when the first thing that I delegated was like babysitting. I hired some childcare a couple days a week when my youngest one, the other ones were in school and my youngest one was still a toddler. And I really was growing the business and I really needed those few hours. So the afternoons, she went to a very loving in-home daycare and it bought me peace of mind and extra time for my business. And so that's the first thing. The next things were domestic, believe it or not, things that were taking me away from doing my best as an entrepreneur, lawn care, grocery shopping, like Instacart or Shipt or wherever it is that you're from that you can use those. I mean, time saver, money saver, and both. I mean, I'm actually saving about $75 a week. I actually did the math, hiring someone to do grocery shopping for me, whether it's Shipt or my daughter used to do it for a time. Now she's got a full-time job, so she can't. But literally was saving me $75 a week while I was paying someone because those are, you know, the Instacart person doesn't add extras to your cart. So you're saving both time and money when it comes to that, to where it's like, oh, look at this cute shirt from Target. And pretty soon I have groceries and $200 worth of stuff I probably didn't need. So that really has saved me both time and money. I've always hired domestic first. And then when it came to business tasks, really the things that I was weakest at is what you hire your weaknesses, right? So I was hiring my weaknesses of things that I absolutely despise and was not even good at.
Oh, this is awesome because I love that you went to the domestic tasks first and not the business tasks necessarily, right? Because especially when you're starting a business, if you delegate away, like, okay, let's say cleaning your house takes 4 hours on a Saturday, that time is precious time. You could either be spending that with your family when you're not working, or you could be building your business. And so it's such a powerful thing to think about, like writing down all of the things that you spend your time on and which one of those is going to be your highest priority delegation away list as fast as possible. And it might start with domestic stuff. It might start with a bookkeeper. Who knows what it is for you specifically, but start that list immediately, no matter what level you're at in your business, and keep adding to it. Because you all know here, I talk about working from your zone of genius, which is exactly what Kristin is doing. She's up leveling her time to spend more and more of it on what it is she loves to do. If you said like a percentage of time you spend in your zone of genius, what would you say it is?
Oh, it's really high.
Yeah.
I'm so picky about
Yeah, these. That's awesome.
I haven't always been, you know, again, going back to CEO and janitor at some point, you know, we all have it in the beginning, we have to do it all. And it's exhausting. And it's one of those things where it's constantly pulling you out of your level of genius. And the only way for me to gain, I mean, I don't know if I could put I would say 80 or 80 plus. I mean, I'd like it to be a little higher. I think I'm just kind of undervaluing that. But the reality is that the more you can hire people to do things that are not only not your level of genius, but things you can't stand. You might be really, really good at something and still hate it. Hello, that's me and data entry. Like, I am really good at the attention to some of the details and things like that. But like, I would rather chew off my big toe than have to do data entry. So that's one of the things I do to hire out, just be like, okay. And there's people that love what you hate. That's something that you really need to embrace about hiring people, is that you may not love mowing the grass, but my BFF loves to mow the grass because, number one, the kids have to leave her alone. She cranks inappropriate music in her headset and she pushes that lawnmower with glory, because it gives her an hour to herself. To where for me, if I have to go out there and mow the grass, I'm like, I'd rather do anything else. I want to sit in the sun. I want to read a book. I want to go to the beach, but I do not want to mow the lawn. So because of these things, like, there's people that love what you hate. So don't feel like you're always offloading your dirt to someone. There are people that love data entry. They love just constantly putting numbers into bookkeeping. Like, if that's not something you don't love to do, find someone who does and hire them appropriately. Everyone will be happier.
Yes. My husband always says delegate to elevate. I'm like, yes. And so it elevates your income because it elevates your energy. And then your energy is more attractive because, you know, I talk a lot about the law of attraction. So it's like the higher your level of energy, more easily you're attracting easier money your way. And it's impossible to attract your way what you love when you're doing what you hate.
Absolutely.
Right? So I love that you said that. So that is like a quotable quote. There are people who love what you hate, so delegate. There are people who love what you hate, so delegate. And so it's also what you're saying there that's really important. Drop the guilt about delegation and the fear, right? There's two things. It's like people are afraid that they're going to waste money, and good delegation will save you money and make you money. And then there's people who go like, oh, someone's doing because you hate it. You project that onto them and you think they must hate it too. But exactly like you're saying, you hire them to do the things you hate. They get to love what they're doing. You get to love what you're doing, and everyone wins.
Yes. And of course, you know, the happier you are and the happier your employees are, even people that are doing what is in their zone of genius, because what you have is different than something like my sister and I are like polar opposites. And that's a really good example I always use. Is she's in accounting. She's in accounting. She's in bookkeeping. She does taxes. She like loves to work with numbers. But if you try to put her in front of a camera or a microphone, she'd hide under the table. So it's like one of those things. It's like a perfect example of I like profit numbers and I like money, but I don't want to like get all those calculations. Just give me the bottom lines. Like, what am I making? What am I earning? What am I losing? What do I owe? That's it.
Yeah. That's awesome. I love it. Okay. Tell your backstory, because you have such a powerful entrepreneurial journey. Will you share how you started and, you know, just a little bit about the journey along the way and where you are right now?
Certainly. So out of my husband and I, like high school sweethearts, he was a little bit older, but high school sweethearts really. And, you know, I got married at 19 and had my first child about a year or so later. And it was just kind of, we started a family right out of the gate. And my husband does commercial construction. So he's building buildings, things like that. But it, in Michigan, it's feast or famine. You know, you've got winter, you've got stuff where it just kind of really slows down sometimes. And as a young family, it was a struggle. I wanted to be able to stay home with my children and be able to be there for them, but we also needed some income. And so I started selling some things, and this is back in 2003. So literally almost 20 years. We're almost at 20 years. As I started selling some things on eBay along the way, like my kids' clothes and toys and dresses and things like that, just to like make ends meet, just to break even, almost get them the new sizes, things like that. And then realized that like, not only did I enjoy it, but I was actually making money and not just flipping things for the next size. I was like, well, not only can I buy her a new dress, but I can buy myself one. And I was like, this is great. This is real income. And it was very convenient for me to be able to work in the hours that I could work and still value that time with my husband and my family. Because at one point we were working opposite jobs and I was leaving and he was getting home and we're like not a family. And I didn't want that. And so I really started to do e-commerce. I started with eBay and then eventually graduated, I say, to Amazon. It's a different beast. So it's a whole different platform. But then I've built my business up to seven figures from that. But in the meantime, I had a third child back in 2010, actually. And my husband was injured a week after she was born. And It was almost a career-ending injury. He hurt his shoulder. He was immediately off work, had to have surgery. And within that year that he was off for this surgery physical therapy that followed the shoulder injury, we were denied workers' compensation from some lawyer issues that we had to end up fighting in court. And so we instantly went from having a regular stable income to almost nothing. My business at that time was just not very many years old. It was kind of a side hustle type of thing, and it wasn't full-time pay. And so we ended up losing our home to foreclosure, and we had to start all over with basically and so it had been a real struggle even building a business for, you know, a shorter amount of years. It just wasn't enough to feed a family of five for a full time. You know, we still needed him. We weren't at the point where we're like, yay, we're free. And so it was just a real struggle to try to rebuild that up. But in the meantime, I kept both businesses. Actually, Mommy Income didn't start until shortly after that. It was a couple of years after the foreclosure when we got back on our feet and I realized, hey, I do know a little something about this e-commerce thing and maybe I should start teaching people. And so that's when Mommy Income was born in 2014. I've been teaching people to start and grow on e-commerce since then. So.
Okay. So when he had the injury, your businesses were only a side hustle.
At that time, yeah, I was just bringing in some side income. I had been in business and consistently been selling things, but you know, we're talking, you know, not enough money to support a family of five. You know, I wouldn't necessarily call it even a side hustle at that point. It was, you know, $20,000 a year or so is nothing to sneeze at, but it was something that was just still building. It wasn't going to be able to support us with a mortgage and things like that.
Wow. So what did you, when that happened, did you just hustle and like what, how did you recover?
Oh, I sat down with a whole box of tissues and a bottle of wine.
Many nights in a row.
That was like, just kind of realized that we were a financial disaster. We were a disaster. We were a young couple. We lived on credit for so many years. We just barely got by most of the time. We were happy, but we were just like barely getting by. And that's how I knew that I needed to kind of step it up a little bit. And I just happened to be really good at what I was doing and loving it. So you couldn't take me away from it. But as we started to recover, we did eventually, you know, he eventually went back to work. But during that time, what he was doing was literally holding a baby with his bum shoulder and single typing. And we were doing it together because he couldn't do anything else but help me with one bum arm. And he's always worked in construction. So that was, you know, a transition for him for a time. Yeah, he was like, this is temporary, but he jumped in and helped. And what we did was, although we couldn't save our house, we did the best we could to save our family from just like really going under. And we ended up saving a tiny bit of money to buy a foreclosure that was basically a disaster, and we had to kind of gut it and start over. So like brick by brick, we just remodeled the house that we're in and slowly built it from, like, we just did our kitchen last year after all these years, you know, we just did little things that we could just move in. And so we kind of took a fixer upper and made it our own and slowly just rebuilt our lives. It's a slow process. I wish I ever could be, I tell everybody, you know, you can make $1 million in 5 years or 2 years or next year. I'm like, how about it took me a decade? Not just to be real, like, it took a decade to get two businesses to be this place. But once you figured out the one, the second one was a lot faster to scale.
Yeah. Yeah. I tell that to people a lot. It's like, don't get these unrealistic expectations of overnight success. Once you have a successful business, let's say that you get to six figures, the next one gets that much easier. And then breaking through to seven, you know, it's the cycle all over again. It's like, once you get that skill set, you know, you can magic wand your way to six figure businesses and feel like it's an overnight success, but you got to get that skill set first and, you know, figure out the phases of business development. So thanks for sharing. That's, I mean, it's amazing and powerful and awesome. And, you know, I'm thinking, like, for anyone here who's watching this at any point in time, if you knew that 10 years from now, you could have a seven figure business, would you be willing to do what it takes to build it? Right? Like, if that's your journey, go for it all the way and just keep staying in the game. Because what I'm hearing from you, Kristin, is that you stayed in the game and you just stayed and you stayed and you kept going and you kept moving forward, even through foreclosure and challenges and things that you didn't foresee were going to happen. You stayed in the game.
Yeah. And the game ended and I started a new game. I mean, it's just like, when you keep going there, I say hungry people work, right? Hungry people really chase their dreams because they can't help it. It's something that's like, you know, that this something can change. You see other people doing it. You see other people being successful, and there's not necessarily a code to crack. It's keep listening, keep learning, keep doing, doing, because you know what? Failure is better than regret. That's another one of my favorite lines, quotes that I say for myself. Like, I didn't get that from anywhere. I just, like, some people say, what is the worst thing in the world? And I'm like, regret. To me, it's regret. It's like, I would rather try and fail and be embarrassed and fall on my face. But, you know, failure is better than regret. You can't fix something if you never tried it. So if you try something and you actually like it, you'd be like, oh, I could do that better. But if you try something and hate it, then you're like, hey, no regrets. I jumped off the plane and it didn't work out for me. I didn't like it. I was scared of that. Yeah. Whatever that is. But I'd rather take the opportunities and take the chance at failing than walk away going, I coulda, woulda, shoulda, because those are feelings that I have a hard time reconciling.
Yeah. Wow. Gold mine of wisdom here. Okay. This is a great spot to share. I always like to ask three tips to help watchers, viewers, listeners, wherever you're engaging with this, how to get to six figures faster. And when I say it, that qualifier faster, it's like faster than you're currently getting there now, you know, whether that takes you 6 months, a year, 10 years, whatever it is, like we talked about staying in the game. What would you say are three tips to help entrepreneurs get to six figures faster? What are the things that you wish you could go back and tell yourself?
Hire faster. So we've already talked about delegating. That is the number one tip. I'm not kidding. I don't care if it's just the grocery shopping. I don't care if it's just like someone to come over and do your laundry. Hire something that you can't stand doing and you will immediately feel a burden lifted. Immediately. And I will say one more tip about that. Do not assume, even with business tasks, do not assume that you have to hire someone for part-time or full-time or this long drawn out thing. You can hire projects with Indeed or Upwork or any of these other Fiverr, any of these other things. You can hire just a project and get your feet wet with just a small project for business. Be like, okay, I want them to do this or that. Don't be scared to do it. It gives you, there's a small dip when you usually hire someone, you maybe take a little bit of a hit, but then the growth is 10 times. And I've done it over and over and over. Every time I see, oh, that's going to cost me a little bit of money, but in 3 months, it's going to be choom. And that's what happens every time. So hire, whatever it is, hire someone, delegate something, get things off your plate so you can operate in your zone of genius. Number two is keep, even if you have a bookkeeper, even if you have an accountant, keep close tabs on your numbers, because we all want it to be sunshines and rainbows and, hey, business is going good, or I did this or did that, but it can get away from you as fast as it can, as fast as you can ignore it, you know? So keep tabs on your numbers. I suggest people do at least, I mean, once a month is at the very minimum, but sometimes once a week, you can just check in on your money and say, hey, money, how are we doing? What do we need? What do we not need? It's just another system and a process that you look at and say, this is a resource that gets me closer to my goals. How do I best use this resource? So keep an eye on your numbers. Some, you should know, in my opinion, you should know at any moment, like, how much is your company profitable? How much are you actually making? What is your dollar per hour? What is your value when it comes to a monetary value, so that your tasks can meet your value and so on? And let's see, the third tip to get to six figures faster. I just let me think on my feet for a second here, because there's so many, but I'm like, narrowing it down. I hate the word faster. You know I do. It's fast, but okay. So, stay away from the comparison monster.
Oh,
the comparison monster will kill you. Number one, because all it does is make you feel like crap. Like, no matter what, you can't compare. Same thing with you, Dr. Amanda. You cannot compare my chapter 20 to your chapter one. And like, we have to know, if you are going to play the comparison game, give yourself a time limit, give yourself 15 minutes, and literally then write it down and be like, she has this, I don't, she has this. Okay. And then look at how petty it really is. Like, honestly, don't compare your chapters to somebody else's. You're at a different journey. You have different resources. You have different support. You have different hair. Like, it literally does not matter. Your journey is never going to be the same as someone else. But what you're allowed to do is compare you to you. So where were you a year ago? And how far have you come? And where would you like to go? Because I don't like to spend, I give my pity parties or my looking back or my comparisons a time limit. It's like, you get 15 minutes to whine about this, and then you have to move on. So I give myself permission to feel all the feels, even if they're yucky, even if it's like, yeah, you're right, I do have FOMO, or I do have jealousy, or I do have any of these things. And then I examine it. I'm like, why? Why do I feel like this? How do I feel like this? And how the hell can I get out of this pit and move on to where I'm supposed to be? Because this ain't pretty. I'm like, so let's go and do right. So give yourself permission to have those little talks with yourself, your little pity parties, whatever they are, comparisons, and then look at you from last year. Look at you from 10 years ago and say, oh my gosh, I have come a long way. And where do I want to go from here? Because comparison will literally fear you to death. You will sit there in the corner and cry if you're constantly looking at what everybody else is doing that you're not doing. So, you know, different journeys, different paths, compare, but only to yourself.
So many good things. You know, I'm looking at these three tips that you offered. So, okay. So here they are. Recap for everyone. Get to six figures faster, as fast as you choose on your path. Higher, faster. And let's show this one. Number two, keep close tabs on the numbers. And number three, stay away from the comparison monster. So these are gems of wisdom. I can see in my process and journey the exact same things, like going like, oh, at the faster that you decide to hire, the faster that you can step into your zone of genius. And it does at first feel that way. You're like, oh, I'm going to put this money up front. And it's a little bit scary. And it's kind of like taking the leap off of the cliff and then just going like, I trust this is going to work. And then you notice all this freedom, because you freed yourself up from things that you no longer choose to be spending your time on. And then it, you know, I always think of delegation as duplicating yourself. You know, so you're taking parts of yourself, like, oh, this person who used to be the janitor in my business, or this person who used to be the bookkeeper in my business, now gets delegated away, and I get to offload that part of it to someone who loves doing it. And then I get to step more and more into the time of what I choose to do. We talked a lot about delegation already. So what I wanted you to share here, when you say keep close tabs on your numbers, could you give like three numbers that you think are important for people to focus on as they're building their business? Like, is it expenses? Is it profit? Is it what are the numbers that they need to be aware of?
I am more concerned with I think, well, number one thing I want people to really understand, if I could even pick one of those, it would be track your time for 7 to 14 days. And I know that seems like a lot and people like roll their eyes and they don't do this task, but it was revolutionary to me. What I realized when I actually tracked every minute. Now you can just delegate this for your business or you can do your whole life. I did whole life. And I literally at 15 minute increments, I wrote down for 2 straight weeks exactly the tasks I was doing. There was no judgments. There was no lying. There was no anything. It was just like, what do I usually do during the day? And then I analyzed that and realized that like at that time that I did this, which was I think 7 or 8 years ago, I was making now, mind you, I was charging an hourly rate for coaching calls and things like that, but I was literally making $17.83 per hour. And wow. At that time, I was like, you know, like right now, that's almost minimum wage where most people live, you know, and I was looking at that time and I was like, okay, I'm like, I for sure can do better than this. I'm like with all the tasks I'm doing. And that's what really caused me to look at all of these things and say, what are minimum wage tasks? Because it's not that there's anything wrong with these things or that they're beneath you or something like that. Like we have to be able to willing to take out our trash and write our marketing emails. We have to do everything at first. But when I was looking at that, it really made me realize that like, if I'm getting this amount per hour from my clients, and yet my average per hour is $17.83, what am I going to do about that? Because this is the level I'm being paid, but not 40 hours, right? So I realized there was a lot of tasks that I could get off of that list once I actually took the time to write down the fact that I do dishes 5 days a week and I do them for about 35 minutes. And who else can fill that spot? Because what could I do? I can earn more than $17.83 an hour by not doing dishes than I am doing. Yeah. So I'm just using that as an example. Same thing with business tasks, same thing with that. So it's part of delegating, but more importantly, it's knowing how much you're paid per hour to do the things you're doing in, you know, if you go to a job and you punch in, you have an hourly rate. And regardless of what you're doing with that hour, you're making that much money and you're not going to make any more unless you work on commission. Well, as entrepreneurs, that's not true. We can actually change that number anytime we want by getting rid of these tasks. So my challenge and my tip is really track your time. You don't have to do 15 minute increments, but there's so much time that's lost. So I suggest 15 minute increments, set a timer for even one whole day. And then just every 15 minutes it goes off and you write down the exact tasks you did for the last 15 minutes. It doesn't take very long, but once you see that, I think you're going to be completely shocked at really how you do spend your time and what you could take off of your plate in order to give yourself an instant raise.
Ugh. Man, genius. Okay. The thing that I think is amazing is that these tips you're giving are so simple to follow. And I always like to remind people that success leaves clues. So, you know, Kristin, you're a 7-figure business owner. And I know that a lot of people here want that. Like that is something that you aspire to. So listen to Kristin. This, I so agree with you. When I've done time blocking and time tracking, I'm like blown away by how much it changes the way I spend my time and how I have a boost of up level when I'm aware of it. So, you know, the things we're talking about here that are important, awareness. You got to be aware. If you don't know where you are, you don't know how to get where you want to go because you don't even have a starting point. So you got to track your time to know, how are you spending your time right now? Is this the best use of my time? Is one of my favorite questions that I ask myself all day long. Is this the best use of my time? Is this the best use of my time? Is this because if it's not, delegate it away, drop it. So I always say drop, automate, delegate, drop, automate, delegate, right? And you can't do that unless you're aware of your time.
And the whole 15 minute thing is not some number, magic number that I made up. I actually have what's called the 15 minute hustle. This is my 15 minute hustle chart. And this is part of the whole story is in my book. And you can learn more about that or go to 15minutehustle.com and you could, you know, download that or whatever. I know that's not the CTA we talked about, but the reality here is that this is something that I've lived and died on. It's called 15 minute hustle. When I was first running my business, a long time ago. My son is 21 now. So if you think about this, he was about 2 or 3 years old, and he was like Dennis the Menace meets like Curious George, like Tasmanian Devil, if you will. He was wild. He was sweet, but he was wild and crazy and broke stuff and got, he was curious and got into everything and was always running all over the place. And what I realized was, whether it's business or any other thing, I only had about 15 minutes to do the things that I needed to do before I had to go and wrangle him and get him out of trouble or prevent him from hurting himself or others. And 15 minutes was my magic number. So what I would do is this all explanation is at the 15minutehustle.com or mommyincome.com/15 minutes. And you can get like the chart and the little mini ebook that kind of explains this. But in a brief nutshell, it's really, I created a master list of all the things that I needed to do on a weekly, daily basis. And I had a daily, weekly, monthly. And anytime I had 15 minutes that I could grab off of that list, I'm like, okay, what's the next thing on the list? Oh, okay, I can do this. And it doesn't have to be completed in that time, but it's just something that when you have a window of time, especially if you're short on time, 15 minutes is enough to get started and get things done. And what I'd realize is, if I have a whole closet to clean out, in 15 minutes I could get it started. And by the end of the week, the closet's cleaned out, rather than like 4 hours on a Saturday where you don't want to clean out the closet. So the 15-minute hustle gave me so much more efficiency in life because I didn't have to stop and think, well, I have 15 minutes. What am I going to do with it? And nowadays, that was 20 years ago before social media. So now that we have social media, the first thing we do is, I have 15 minutes. Who can I scroll? And what can I see? What can I distract myself to? But that's not how you make 7 figures, people. You don't be scrolling on Instagram looking at all that. There's time and a place for that. But when you have 15 minutes, pick something off your list and just get it done.
Boom. Man, all I want to say is you're a badass. I love it. And that is, it's so true. Like, when you become a master of your time, you become a master of your money.
Yeah.
You really become a master of everything. Have you heard of Parkinson's Law? Do you know Parkinson's Law?
I'm not sure.
Okay. So it's work expands to fill the time allotted. So when you give yourself 15 minutes to do a task, you're more likely to finish it than if you give yourself, you know, you might finish it in 20 minutes or 15 minutes versus 2 hours, right? Yeah. So it's like when I go to check my email, I'll actually set a timer and be like, this is how long I have to check these emails. And so I'm efficient, effective, and I'm on track. So I love that 15-minute hustle because it's that philosophy of like, you might not finish the whole project in those 15 minutes, but you're going to use that 15 minutes very powerfully because you know that's all you've allotted to it and that you have these other 15-minute tasks to do. So I love that. I live by my life by Parkinson's Law.
Yeah. By the timer.
That's awesome. I swear.
Like, this thing is actually a silent timer, but it's a visual representation on my desk of like,
I love it.
You're on the clock. And I think for entrepreneurs, that one was obviously on me. Your time's up. No. As entrepreneurs too, you don't have that boss, that built-in accountability of someone saying, hey, are you being distracted? Are you? And I find myself procrastinating and distracted with like, just because you're busy doesn't mean you're making progress toward your goals. I have all kinds of things I can be busy with, but am I moving towards my goals? And I only have 4 things on my to-do list every day because I believe that if you only have these 15-minute hustles, you can get more done by being this intentional than you can anywhere else. So I make my intentions for the day and I'm like, if I get these 4 things done, I am a rock star. And what happens is I end up getting way more than that done. And sometimes I get one of those done because I'm so focused. But the idea is that it's intent. It's like, if I only get 4 things done and 4 15-minute hustles today, I'm lapping the people that are doing nothing.
Yeah. I'm curious because you are very efficient and I'm really efficient with my time too. And people often are like, how do you get so much done? And it's exactly the things you're talking about. So I'm curious for you, do you feel like you also, like, do you schedule in relaxation time? Do you feel like you get enough relaxation time at this stage in your business?
Absolutely. I live and die by that. The thing is, the reason I'm so efficient is because in the beginning, I'll be honest, when I was building and I was really paying attention to all this, I worked a lot. I was a workaholic. Yeah. I didn't relax as much then. And that is one of the things that now, instead of regret, I am just intentional. I'm like, I have office hours now, just like you would, quote unquote, a 9 to 5. I have specific office hours. And when that thing, that clock reaches that 4 p.m. when my daughter's going to get home from school and everything, it's like, I'm sorry, out of the office. The office is closed. So occasionally I work past those times, but it's very rare because in order to be the most efficient I can at work and to operate in such a high level of genius. And when I am, I need that yin yang kind of opposite. I actually play cornhole as part of my relaxation. I'm such an active person, like as far as like I have a lot of energy and my mind is very active. So I actively relax. I have to be doing still. So whether it's coloring or something like that, but I love playing cornhole because it's just something that's physical. It's something that's absolutely opposite from sitting here all day doing these things. So it's something that I don't even have to plan and schedule it anymore. It's just part of my everyday life, relaxation type things like that, because for so many years it wasn't, and I was burned out. And so I decided that it's either I have to start being better for me, or so I can be better for my clients, better for my family, whatever else. And I can't tell you how much that's really changed my life to be able to say, you know what? I'm important enough to take care of. And the better I take care of me, the better I can take care of everyone else. And I know that that's something everyone's talking about these days, and self-care and this and that, but give it a try. It's actually real. It's not just talk, and it's not just a buzzword. It's like, if you do stuff that you love every day, everything becomes better. Yeah. And your work becomes better. Your relationships become better because you're a whole happy person. And if you can arrive in those places, I say arrive because it's a work in progress. It will be evolving into that person that you want to be. But overall, checking in with yourself and being like, how am I today? You know, has anybody asked me that? How am I today? I'm not great. What do I need? I need relaxation. I need 10 minutes of sunshine. I need a walk. I need a water. I need to punch something, like whatever.
Go play cornhole, like go on a walk. It's amazing to me how we get, I think it's because entrepreneurship just tends to attract type A driven people, right? And so then you go, oh, it's easy to forget that I need to check in with myself and make time for relaxation, just like you would a date on the calendar for an appointment for a consult or something else. Make a calendar date for yourself for self-care time. My business changed a lot when I started doing this too, because the first year, man, I hustled. I worked a lot. And then that next year I was like, if I keep working this hard, I'm going to hate my business. I don't want to work this hard. And so I really started to block out, like, and then I started to have Fridays be where I don't schedule appointments. And then, you know, and then I just keep adding to it. And so, you know, it's really important, everyone here, to implement what you're learning here. Don't just listen to it and forget it right when you leave. Implement. So wrapping up, I'm curious I always give a book recommendation. So this is your book, and I wanted to make sure, is that the correct, it's the number 15, 15 minute hustle?
Yep. 15minutehustle.com. That's that. And if you want the full book, that's like the ebook, and there's a way you can order that. Also on my website, mommyincome.com. If you go to courses and or offerings, I have a section that comes with a chart like this. It's already laminated. Comes with the ebook and also a signed copy of my real book, which is Dream Big, Step Small. So people can get that there as well. You can check that out. They're both also on Amazon if you want to check that out there.
Wonderful. Okay. And then I know that you're going to want to connect with Kristin. So here is a great way to connect. Oh, and you know what? I'm going to make that bigger so that everyone can see it really well. So if you go to mommyincome.com/roadmap, will you share what they're going to find there?
The roadmap is your roadmap to your first sale. If you're interested in starting and growing a business with e-commerce on Amazon, I am your Amazon expert, almost 20 years, and you can get your roadmap to your first sale right there at mommyincome.com/roadmap.
Nice. That's awesome. Is it pretty easy to start an Amazon business? When I say easy, meaning like step-by-step process and you can get it started.
Following my directions, it is.
Okay, awesome.
It really is. You know, it can be for anyone in the world. Like right now, for example, my mom, who is 65 plus, running, she's my full-time business partner in Amazon, and she was able to retire from her job about 10 years ago and do Amazon full-time remotely. So if she does it remotely, there's no inventory to touch or move. If you do it, you know, the way I teach, there's multiple ways to have a store. Yeah. It's an amazing opportunity for anyone who's looking for something that's remote, that if you have the internet and a computer, you can certainly do it from anywhere.
Awesome. Okay. So everyone, if you're looking for a business, you're looking for a side hustle, you're looking for a full-time hustle, you're looking to build a business, make a ton of money, Kristin, 7 figures. Okay. So check out her mommyincome.com roadmap. And then you all know where to find me. And I'm loving my NFA money formula. Oh, let's see. I gotta hide that. Let's start over here. Okay. So if you are looking to make more money in your business, one of my specialties is breaking down action steps into the simplest process possible to help you transform your money mindset so that you can attract easier money your way. So I actually just revamped the 3-step formula. I didn't change the core formula, but I changed the steps to get there. And I've been using it with my clients in the last 2 weeks, using it on myself in this new way. And it is awesome. So make sure you go to nfamoneyformula.com, check it out. There's a 15-minute video with a cheat sheet that you download instantly and you can start implementing it right away. And in our lasting comment, what would you say is a number one money confidence tip to leave people with?
Think before you buy. Ooh. Literally nothing cannot wait 24 hours. Nothing. So literally just wait. After 24 hours, if you still have that gut instinct that says this will help my business, FOMO is real and people buy stuff all the time, especially business courses and this, that, and the other thing. But you have to ask yourself that question. Is this particular purchase right now going to get me closer to my goals right now? Because a lot of times we buy stuff, we buy courses or we buy this or we buy that to think that it's going to help. Oh, down the road, I'm going to need this. But right now, for the next 24 hours, it's only $27, whatever. We've all run the sales. We've all had the sales. We've all bought the sales. Reality is, if you don't stop and ask yourself, is this something I'm going to watch and implement right now? Then the answer is no. So if it does not get you to your goals right now, then say no.
Boom. That is an awesome NFA money tip. I love it. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you everyone else for being here. Watch, if you're on YouTube, watch the next video in this. If you're watching later, you will see the whole NFA Money Talks playlist. This is with awesome, incredible 6- and 7-figure entrepreneurs who are helping you break through to 6 figures faster. Until next time, NFA money making high fives. Bye everyone.